We would like to start also with thank yous to Carol Podwarny and Ihor back, Kolobisky, for bringing the exhibition here. Thank you. You jumped right on and got it for us. And of course, to Laurie Polly for curating and designing the exhibition. And to Mills Library, Rick Stapleton and his staff for allowing us to actually take these out and bring them with us. But as always, we both need to thank the Mulholland family, Joseph Mulholland and his family, for being the custodians of Margaret Watkins' photographs and her archive. They are the ones that rescued them. So we'd like to thank them, and I'd like to thank Joseph's daughter, Efa, who's here tonight, lives in Toronto. And we actually would like to dedicate tonight's talk to Claire Mulholland, a great artist in her own right, who passed away in July. So we want to present as a theme for tonight's talk, coming home. But coming home in terms of both returning and also a sense of presence. Hopefully that'll become clear as we go through. So Margaret Watkins was born Meta Gladys Watkins in 1884 in our city in Hamilton. But she left in her 25th year to go to the United States to start a life, to find a life. So she hasn't been back, perhaps she came back once or twice, but she hasn't lived here since 1908 in November. But today, in terms of presence, here we have her photographs, and here and in our library's basement, we have all her papers over all her life. Not all her papers, but many of them. So we want to ask, what does it mean to welcome Margaret Watkins back to Hamilton? What does it mean to have her first exhibition of her work in her hometown? And what does it mean for us to be looking at these photographs in 2014? So Kathy's in my book, 2007 book, tried to understand Watkins in terms of her life and her work, in terms of really a woman trying to find an art practice that fit with her time, that was relevant for her time, and a way to engage with the world that she lived in. But it's also a story with relevance to our own time, with questions about women's labor, about creative labor, and about the relationship between culture and commerce. Thanks. So we believe she will be remembered, and this has been said by all those who work on Margaret Watkins, she'll be remembered for her still life images, radical in their time, these domestic still life images, radical in their time, combining modernist interest in design and geometric form and strange angles, together coupled with, and really coupled with, traces of everyday life, not entirely sanitized or transcended, refusing to erase the material reality, such as dirty dishes that are always there, always have to be done. She'll also be remembered, we believe, for truly extraordinary images and later photographs of industrial Glasgow and sites in USSR and Germany and France. In these, she took what she'd learned in the 20s about cropping and point of view and added what she learned from the new German and Russian objectivist artists to show, for instance, these Glasgow workers enmeshed in their industrial scene. Or, with her persistent sense of irony, a self-portrait as a reflection off modernity's surfaces, supervised by the police. But let's begin with the home she's coming back to. In her own words, and Kathy and I are going to do this, we're going to stand in for Margaret Watkins as we go. So whenever you get the other, you're hearing Margaret Watkins is present, so.
Born in Hamilton, Ontario, brought up on pictures and music.
So it was a privileged life. She was born in a big house on King Street East, that's no longer there. It's east of Victoria Street. Her father, Frederick W. Watkins, was a prominent merchant in the city, owning a large dry goods store on James Street South, but just above James Street North. He was a very public person, an alderman in the city, working on projects for sanitation, an elder in the Centenary Methodist Church, a church that Mita also sang in the choir for. And interestingly, he was also a member of the Hamilton's Art School's Committee of Examinations, so he actually examined artists. His wife, Marion Watt Anderson, was born in Glasgow and from a prominent family also in the dry goods business. They had a huge, what's called a warehouse. No,
department store?
No, neither. Warehouse, I think. Sorry. In the 19th century, it's called something. It's not a department store. So Margaret's world was full of women. Four of her mother's five sisters took turns coming to live in Hamilton with the family, looking after the house with their sister and bringing up Mita. So Mita really was brought up intermittently by five different women. And all of these women, we learned from the archives, actually did crafts themselves. And one was even selling her ironwork at the Canadian Exhibition in her time, in the 19th century. So when Margaret's father went bankrupt in 1899, 1 year after he had built a new store of 48,000 square feet and had been touted in the press as the Wanamaker of Hamilton, Margaret turned to crafts to make some money for the family. One of her aunts writes home to Glasgow after the bankruptcy to say they have pulled Mita out of school and she is making a box of fancy things, such as pen wipers and pudding dish tidies. Now you can go on Google and find these things. To sell at the very store her father had just lost. Her aunt adds in this letter, she has been quite businesslike about it. I sometimes think of this as a kind of primal scene for Margaret. Mita then becomes Margaret. The father has failed, and Mita becomes the savior of the family by producing art, by inventing and making objects with her hands. And it's an art that is firmly grounded in the everyday. As she leaves Hamilton and her bourgeois home, never to return, she will repeat that life of hard work and continual struggle to save situations, often with great deal of physical labor. She always saw herself as both an artist and someone having to make a living out of her artist's talents. Her journey towards New York and photography took 7 years. She started by joining various arts and crafts communities in the United States. First, the Roycroft community in East Aurora, New York. Then something called the Lanier Camp in Maine, where she was a camp photographer, taking photographs of camp life and particularly of a series of Bible plays for which she was also designed and made the costumes. As an itinerant artist, which she was, Watkins never had a place of her own, was always in precarious jobs, working really hard, but with little and often no pay. Let's keep getting that in her archive. She'd begun to learn photography in Boston in 1913, as an apprentice in a portrait studio place called Arthur Jameson's, no longer, it's now forgotten. She borrowed money in 1914 to go to Clarence H. White's summer school. All of these photographs show the influence of this pictorialism that was taught in the school to begin with. There are examples in this exhibition of pictorialist characteristics like soft focus, representations that remind us of paintings or painterly effects in the images. So for instance, in the first room, you'll see a beautiful, I can see it from here, but you can't, portrait of Josephine in sunlight with her, the backlit or the side lit light on her hair. Or you can, some of you can see, first portrait here, portrait of Verna Skelton, who actually lived in Walkerton, Ontario, close friend of Margaret's, which was certainly an imitation of Julia Margaret Cameron's photography. But there's others around the side of the wall there that take the composition or the chiaroscuro of 17th century or Renaissance paintings. And on the other side, you can see something called Dutch Girl Reading, which definitely comes out of a art history book. Watkins' photograph that she calls Opus 1 is an experiment with isolating objects, cropping, and geometric form. And this shows the other side, not just the pictorialist side, but the other side of this school's teaching, which was to emphasize modernist design and two-dimensional surfaces, which for Watkins would eventually move to the sort of clarity of image in The Wharf 5 years later. In November 1915, Watkins moves to New York City, finally, and gets a job as an assistant to Alice Boughton, two of whose portraits of Margaret of Watkins are in the middle inset room in the next room. And a year later, with a small inheritance from a cousin, she's able to rent an apartment of her own, finally, on Jane Street in Greenwich Village. Here, she set up home and studio. In 1919, she gave up her job with Boughton and began to teach at the Clarence White School, where she also helped administer and was actually a personal assistant to Clarence White. The Jane Street apartment, which was also her studio, brought her working, domestic, and artist life into a unified set of activities. And the best image we have of this new life, artist life, is in a written portrait of a piece of furniture she had inherited from home.
The cabinet is in the living room, the china on top. Desk parts hold all chemicals and retouching materials. Top drawer, portfolios of prints, all labeled and in shape to show people. Middle drawer, portfolios of pictures, engravings, colored prints, and copies of old masters, which we trot out and study every little while when we want amusement. And bottom drawer, the largest, is jammed full of mending and sewing materials to be handy when there's time to spare.
So this was a home, finally, but it was a home space in which domestic labor lay beside or under with art labor, domestic commodities beside objects of study. And although they were kept separate in separate compartments, separate drawers, they were integrated into her working and living life. So this self-portrait at the entrance, it's at the entrance of the exhibition, was taken in 1923. And I must confess, when I looked at it again lately, I thought, this looks like a selfie. so I started thinking, and what she is actually doing with this photograph is preparing an image for publicity in 1923. So she takes this photograph, figures out how to do it on her own, and is excited by the technology and the contraption that she's devised, and a way of presenting herself to the public.
Miss Watkins took this portrait of herself by means of an ingeniously devised mechanism.
Which is the bottom here. She sent the photograph to a Miss Street, who was part of the publicity committee of the New York City branch of the Zonta Club. Zonta Club is an organization still alive today to help women of business get ahead. I'm interested in this photograph as a kind of act of self-publication. Knowing she must circulate if she is to get recognition, her photograph must go out there now in 1923. And she wants to get it right. So the image got reproduced with her own photographs in the New York Sun and Globe. So it was a nice publicity event for her own work and her career. But the editors of this newspaper touched it up, and they made it look as if she actually had makeup. They put black eyeliner and lipstick, and they put it in an oval along with her other pictures. She was furious.
To ye engraver, don't clip, prune, or place this in an oval. Neither retouch and paint to the semblance of a snake-eyed vamp.
So here in 1923, she has a strong sense of who she is and what her aesthetic is and is not, as well as possession of great sense of humor and cutting irony. But she knew darn well that she did not want to be commodified as a Hollywood femme fatale, a sexual object, or a prim bourgeois matron in her lovely ideal home. The photograph was accompanied by a letter of June 15th to Miss Street, a draft of which is in the archive, offering a quick bio for the newspaper article.
Born in Hamilton, Ontario, brought up on pictures and music, came to the United States in 1908, studied photography in 1914, and have been learning ever since. Have exhibited prints throughout the United States, also Denmark and Japan, receiving bronze medal from Kobe last year. Have published photographs in Vanity Fair and Shadowland, and am presently working for a one-man show to be held next autumn, probably at the Art Center. And as a flippant finale to this solemn record, I adore cheese and do my own carpentry.
Vanity Fair had compared her work, and you can see, I think it's in the box display, there's a page from Vanity Fair, had compared her work in 1921 to Brancusi and Picasso, while her portrait of another Zonta figure, portrait of Nina B. Price, which is this photograph, abstraction, a geometric study of her hat, Nina Price's hat, her clock, her book, her lampshade, her wallpaper, but with leaving, of course, for Margaret, leaving as a geometric composition the shadow of the shade of the lampshade in the center of the photograph of light. One critic called this purely geometric design, reminiscent of the idealist prose of Gertrude Stein of Tender Buttons fame. And then in Margaret Watkins' copy of Katherine Dreyer's Western Art and the New Era, and there's a portrait of Katherine Dreyer at the back. Katherine Dreyer was friend of Marcel Duchamp. They started the Society Anonyme together. In her Watkins copy, she put the portrait of Dreyer at the front, and to really position her, she wasn't mentioned in this book, but to position herself as a modern artist, at the back, she's put the photograph of Nina Price, the portrait. Thank you. The Gertrude Stein piece. Her prize-winning kitchen sink elicited great controversy about what can be represented in art. We're talking 1922. Cameracraft in that year spent two pages praising its geometric order, all the angles and the connections. But another critic said it's suffering from containing too many objects of equal interest.
Evidently, the poor duffer doesn't know anything about modern art, abstractions, pattern, rhythm, etc. The objects are not supposed to have any interest in themselves, merely contributing to the design.
Yet, no matter how much we leave the realm of the everyday, habitual, and material world to move into the realm of geometric form, aesthetic design, we cannot fully lose the dirty dishes. In the kitchen sink is repetitive labor, usually of women, certainly in those days, of our material world and the repetitive mundane activities that our bodies require. In short, it was radical in 1919, the year women's suffrage was passed in the House of Representatives and the Senate, to represent the kitchen. To one contemporary reviewer, the kitchen sink is a record of slovenly housekeeping, implying that behind the dirty sink is a woman who is a bad housekeeper, bad, maybe even bad morally, and certainly a bad photographer. Watkins responded,
"Eventually, I did clean up."
In Domestic Symphony, the white sink floats at the upper edge of the picture with its striking form, one piece curving into the other, a lyrical curved line that peaks as it finds the point of contact between the sink and the drying rack. It's repeated, that form, throughout the photograph. It's a photograph of curves, but also of folds and suggested hidden spaces created by the meeting of objects. The sensuality of the photograph is created primarily by these hidden spaces and the suggestive entry points to them. In a comparable image, design curves, these are all in the next room there, Watkins positions her plate and circular wooden tray, this is all in her own kitchen, on the draining board again, to effect a remarkable dark space that forms the center of the photograph.
Simple and inconsequent subject may provide a motive for beautiful and rhythmic patterns which stir emotions quite unrelated to the original subject. The austere abstract beauty of a Bach fugue, theme answering theme, phrase answering phrase.
By 1924, Watkins was advertising herself as a photographer of still life studies for advertising. She was one of the earliest to develop a photographic language for advertising, working at the same time as Edward Steichen, whose advertising photography began in 1923. Patricia Johnson, in her book on Steichen's photography, points out that in the early 1920s, only 15% of illustrations to advertisements were photographs. By 1930, almost 80% were photographs. So we could think about our own time and the shift maybe to digital and internet production. It was Watkins' original work in creating domestic still life studies that led directly to this career as an advertising photographer. Her 1919 ability to isolate household objects and show it in a new light was her most, by this time, marketable skill. Her reputation elicited direct commissions as well as steady contract with Macy's, Walter Thompson advertising agencies, and others. So in a complex way, Watkins' particular interest in the home or inheritance of the home and its objects led to this reformulation of modernist photographic images, ready to be caught by the new advertising of her time. Her 1919, 1921 images of pots and pans and knives and cups or sink and soap on a bathroom rack were rewritten and reframed for a seductive advertising image of domestic commodities. So a discovery of how a home might be newly documented, shaped, and cropped was easily transferable into a representation of desire for domestic objects. If everyday life could be aestheticized, it could also be sold. An art director at J. Walter Thompson wrote to her requesting photographs for a toothpaste campaign and asking for the inner line of the washbowl or the fat, round lines of the porcelain bays of a faucet, smart touch of a modern bathroom. Please take your time and bring us the kind of work of yours we all like so well. It's not a great distance to move from Domestic Symphony to Watkins' series of studies for Q-Tech's nail polish campaign. An overt appeal to sexuality is made through paradigmatic techniques of advertising, cropping the body, fetishizing hands and legs, suggesting through anecdotal detail possible sexualized space and figure. The advertising copy suggests the domain is healthful self-care on your nails, but it also suggests a class-based eroticization of a woman at home who prepares her body for both her man and her class peers. Watkins' photographs partake of a new freedom. They play with femininity as much as formal design. Or when necessary, they rewrite what is seen as all too materially feminine in the new language of stark, abstracted modernity. For example, in this brilliant image for Johnson & Johnson's Modest sanitary pads. So, in 1928, Watkins was at the height of her powers.
This is a hard image to follow. Going to a new home. In 1928, Margaret Watkins took a 6-week trip to Europe and ended up staying for 40 years. New theater, new art, new psychology, new fiction, new vision, new women were terms that were used to bring in the 20th century. The world had, in fact, radically changed. This was the Europe in the 1920s that Watkins stepped into. Airplanes and automobiles offered fast means of transportation, and in the case of the plane, a bird's eye view from above, which was then adopted by photographers. The X-ray showed the inside of the body, which had never been seen. Planck's quantum theory and Einstein's theory of relativity introduced the behavior of matter and energy at the subatomic level, which of course I can't explain, so please don't ask. But they changed the concept of the material world. And then there was Freud and dreams. Watkins arrived in Glasgow at 41 Westbourne Gardens, her maternal home inhabited by three elderly aunts. So first, she had to navigate the old.
The youngest is 77 and has been in bed for 5 or 6 years. The next, 80, valiant but very tottery and subject to the most shocking insurrections of the interior. The eldest is 86, a human dynamo, loves the cinema, tries to manage the whole solar system.
The house was cavernous. 4 stories with many rooms, 57 windows, from the attic to the basement, 12 coal fireplaces to stoke, and an attic bathroom which served as a dark room and which was very uncomfortable. Yes. The first floor drawing room had 12 bureaus of bought and handmade goods.
They have more hoards of ancient clothes and household goods. which is, she actually wrote out as goods gods. If I see one more black beaded bodice, I shall scream. Stockings enough for a centipede.
The pipes leaked, water overflowed, and sometimes there was no heat. Watkins was on the edge of falling into a black hole of domesticity. She had to figure out a way to escape and recommit to her career. 6 weeks after her arrival, she went to Cologne and the Press Affair, an international exhibition of new design, advertising, and printing processes. It was one of the legendary encounters between modern art and industry, an encounter which mirrored Watkins' own experience, as we've just heard, and which is resonant now. On the bank of the Rhine, these next five slides are not Margaret Watkins' photographs. On the bank of the Rhine, along a 3-kilometer stretch of land, 40 buildings showed works from the communication industry. The architecture was eclectic. 16th century churches were fitted as exhibition spaces alongside new Bauhaus structures. 24 countries exhibited their new advances in color printing, publications, and advertising.
The USSR, restless, chaotic energy, nothing old, bursting with propaganda. The US, a monument to complacent prosperity, should go way, way back, sit quietly down, do some heavy and much needed thinking. Italy no longer languishes among her ruins.
In this Margaret Watkins photo of one of the exhibition spaces at the fair, reflections from the windows look like film strips, and the archway with the man and child figures as if it was a cinema projection. Cinema was, of course, one of the relatively new art forms, and Watkins loved the movies. In our exhibition here, there's another photo from the Press Affair, somewhere over there. It shows people wandering amid floor-to-ceiling cardboard palm trees. A map of Africa is on the back wall. The palm trees are carved with light, making them shimmer in a way that's not known to industrial cardboard, nor to a real Africa. It was the exhibition of German magazines, Special Colonial Exhibition, a space of illusion where the playful, magical palm trees disguised colonial interests. Music, her constant companion. And thank goodness for Google Images. This is not a Margaret Watkins photo. On the train back to Glasgow, Margaret Watkins surveyed the Scottish landscape, which had its own magical properties.
The earth in places was a marvelous deep red, divided by stone dikes running crazily up and down. There the sun set, or rather exploded, purple and crimson and gold, trumpeting from peak to peak, till they fairly reverberate with color. Somehow, I always mix sight and sound, and this was Wagner with full orchestra.
Music was her constant companion. Her mainstay was a classical repertoire, and she was very knowledgeable.
And the Glasgow Cathedral, it's the perfect setting for Bach. The Choral Society gave the Passion According to St. John at Easter, and if architecture be frozen music, they too were one. Palestrina could have lived up to that vaulting, but Rossini demands squimmerjigs, and Gounod would have revealed as the saccharine drivel that he is.
Longing for home. When Margaret Watkins returned to the anthill, as she called it, she was faced with gas leaks, freezing pipes, ailing aunts, and her own loneliness. She was only 47, and conversation with the aunts was minimal or merely practical. And she had limited collections to the art community in Glasgow.
I miss the artist crowd in New York most desperately. Collectively, they have every failing under the sun. but in spite of their sins, or because of them, they have vision, a strange gleam, something worth striving after. I want to go home, and I haven't got any home. I feel like a cat on the roof of the world.
She left the anthill again to attend a scientific conference on photography in Dresden and to photograph in Paris. A photographic trope we can trace through her travels in Europe and the USSR is the storefront window. The spectacle and exhibition space of a shop window is a site where individuals can project their dreams. In this photo, which is in the exhibition, two women are reflected in a display advertising straight razors, brushes, and other male shaving paraphernalia. This shaving gear is configured as unlikely chandeliers, a sort of Disney fantasia to seduce the shoppers. Amid the excessive quantity of objects and their opulent display, the dull razor has been invested with an edge. Another image of a storefront window, also in the exhibition, is called by Watkins, Godiva and the Gossips. Legend has it that Godiva pleaded with her husband, the mayor of Coventry, to repeal onerous taxes charged to the citizens. After much begging, he finally agreed that if she rode through the town naked, he would repeal the taxes. She was up to the challenge. Although the citizens were forbidden to watch, a peeping Tom cut a hole in the door in his doorway, and he subsequently went blind. Note the one, or perhaps two, shadowy men in the background. In this exhibition, there's also another photo of a storefront window, which has a bust of Lenin facing out towards the spectator. It was taken on Watkins' trip to the USSR in 1933. In the Mulholland archive, there are other photos of Lenin in shop windows, including this one, which Watkins called The Leader and the Worlds, acknowledging the myth of Lenin as the father figure of the Stalinist state, and in this case, the world. Note the image of Stalin on the far right, far left. Right.
Right.
For Watkins, the Soviets were masters of propaganda.
He who cannot read cannot miss the point of the picture.
I like to include this picture because I think it reveals a lot about Margaret Watkins' understanding of photography. The young woman, a photographer herself, waits for customers to photograph in front of her backdrop, with the turreted castle, small aircraft, and distant mountains. Tourists and Soviets can be transported to an imaginary sublime space, while the novel aeroplane, novel in those days, was the promise of a utopian future. By photographing this camera woman and her backdrop, Watkins makes a picture of how the medium of photography can also create myths. In this picture, also in the exhibition, the children and planes, aeroplanes, can be seen as symbols of a bright future. The Soviets had the habit of saying the same thing over and over again to make sure the message was clear. When Watkins arrived in the USSR, it was the end of Stalin's first five-year plan, which was meant to modernize the country from a feudal to a technologically advanced society, and to mobilize the workforce to participate in the development of a socialist state. New construction and reconstruction of existing buildings provided needed housing. This reconstruction, this image, which is called Reconstruction Dining Hall and Workers' Flats opposite Kremlin, is in the exhibition. But it might be because of this picture that Watkins was arrested and carted off to police headquarters in Moscow. She was accused of photographing the barracks of OGPU, a surveillance agency, the forerunner of the KGB. Watkins recorded her impression at the police station.
Each time, after much agitating among the underlings, the commandant clicked his heels and bowed me out with a charming smile, and I was no wiser as to what all the patter was about.
After more delays and phone calls, the commandant suggested that the zeal of his subordinates had been overdone, and Watkins was released. In theory, she and other tourists were able to roam freely in the streets of Moscow. As the travel industry in tourist quoted in their brochure, you can go where you want to go, you can see what you want to see. However, one way to control what tourists saw was to require that all film was processed and inspected before leaving the country.
In 1933, all films developed by official photographers, dearly and badly, shown to tourists, and then returned for censoring and sealing till inspected again at border. Not too drastic.
Watkins returned to Glasgow with over 600 images. Her photographs do not burst the bubble of Stalinist Russia, but she tempers Soviet myth-making with her wit and attention to small, intimate details, like the photo of women standing at a bus stop in the exhibition. Between her trips, Watkins photographed in the city of Glasgow and especially on the Clyde River. She framed the newly constructed Finiston Crane as a dominant 20th century icon. She photographed it from every conceivable location, as though she had
almost made a pet of that crane.
It merged in the spaces between cables, steel girders, and ship hulls, or framed by a doorway of a loading shed. It was seen from across the river by a solitary reader in the evening.
I've seen the shipyard cranes looming in the dusk like a herd of prehistoric monsters.
She photographed from below on the left, and she climbed to the top, no mean feat for a woman of her age, and photographed down.
There is a shot from the giant Finiston, hanging over the rail in a stiff breeze, looking straight down at the squat dome, with little trucks and figures making a beetle pattern of light and dark.
Abstraction. In the 1930s, Watkins' funds were low. She began a series of composite photographs for carpet and textile designs, which she hoped to sell. Once again, she was using her photographic talent to create a saleable object. Design for carpet, blithewood, front steps, centered, is constructed from four identical images, like the one on the right. Like many textile designs, her images are fractals, a geometric formula based on self-reiteration and infinite possibilities. Another commercial design entitled Moscow is made from 15 identical images of the facade of an apartment building, arranged side by side, a dizzying composite. Watkins solicited her next door neighbor to give her a letter of introduction to one of his business contacts who might be interested in her designs, but to no avail. In June 1962, 7 years before she died, she wrote on a piece of paper.
In 1908, November, I left home to build a life and make a living. The quest continues.
In her last years were spent indoors, annotating a large collection of books and memorabilia, many of which we have here. In her copy of A Guide to Parsifal, beneath a musical score of the bell theme, she wrote,
I found a set of gongs tuned to play this in Barrowland, too broke to buy, sad.
Her love of music was constant, although her mainstay was a classical repertoire, her appreciation took unexpected turns.
I've fallen in love with the barrel organs, their raffish gaiety and gusto galore.
But she hated elevator music.
Dismal, drooling dribble made myself listen until convulsed with nervous spasms, not a normal rhythmic response.
Joseph Mulholland recounts that when he met Miss Watkins, as he calls her, in the early 1960s, her bags were packed to go back home. Although the strength of will needed to uproot herself, sell the house, and start again was gone, the fantasy of coming home was persistent. In the archive, there's a 1965 advertisement to Fly Air Canada. It shows three images. A view of Dorchester Street, now Boulevard René Lévesque in Montreal. A view of Malin Lake in Jasper National Park with the lovely, tiny, tranquil Spirit Island. And a man and woman at Niagara Falls, the man with the camera. The advertising copy under the Malin Lake picture stated that this was a favorite location for photographers. Watkins noted,
"Me for this."
Welcome home, Margaret. It's not Jasper, but your hometown of Hamilton, a city that has lost its manufacturing, but is still very much interested in itinerant workers and a creative economy.
Thank you.